بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد, this is a recording from session 1 of this series entitled Al-Mudhakara, a series which seeks to bring to the listeners the experiences, insights and wisdoms from the people of knowledge, students of knowledge as well as mashayikh, inshaAllah. This first session was recorded on the 22nd of Sha'ban 1445 Hijri, coinciding with the 4th of March 2024. The guest on this session was none other than Abu Fajr Abdul Fattah Hafizahullah Ta'ala, who studied in Dammaj for several years, and he is currently in Toronto at Masjid Al-Istiqamah teaching the community over there. This session was recorded a few days before Ramadan, so the theme of this session was around preparation for Ramadan. The speaker began by summarizing a talk that was given by Sheikh Sa'ad al-Shithri, 5-point strategy to prepare oneself for Ramadan. I'm going to summarize the first 4 points because it was not recorded. The first point that the Sheikh mentioned was a person should know the status and excellence of Ramadan, and that includes knowing that the Quran was revealed in this month, knowing that sins are forgiven in this month, knowing that the gates of Jannah are opened and the gates of Jahannam are shut, knowing that Ramadan is a pit stop to strengthen one's taqwa. The second point, cleansing our sins through repentance prior to the start of Ramadan. And this will be a reason for a person to attain greater benefit during Ramadan. And the Sheikh goes on to mention the conditions for tawbah to be accepted. A tawbah and nasuha has several conditions. From them is that a person has to be sincere, he has to be remorseful, he has to refrain from that sin, he has to resolve not to return to that sin, unlike some people who stop the sin temporarily during Ramadan with the intention of going back after Ramadan. This is not a tawbah nasuha. Likewise, if the sin involves transgressing the rights of someone else, then their rights have to be returned back to their rightful owners. The third point that was mentioned was purifying our intentions in everything that we do. We refrain from food and drink, seeking Allah's reward. Waking up and eating suhoor, seeking Allah's reward. Going to sleep, seeking to strengthen for worship. Observing good manners, seeking Allah's reward. Spending in good causes, seeking Allah's reward. And this way, we will be rewarded for everything that we do. The fourth point was to learn and teach others, especially the young ones, the rulings related to fasting as well as the night prayers. And he mentions that the angels, they lower their wings for the student of knowledge in pleasure of his pursuit. These were the 4 points that were missed in the recording. I'm going to pass it over now to Abu Fajr to continue with the 5th point.
Tayyib, on the last point, strategy, inshallah, making full use of the month through good time management. For example, saying istighfar when driving the car, having a plan in place to complete the Quran twice or more. This was demonstrated by the actions of the Salaf al-Salih in the month of Ramadan. They would have practices where they would make commitments to complete the Quran a particular amount of times. So a person should make for him goals of good deeds, striving therein. And this is the Maidan, this is the real field and opportunity plant to see, inshallah, your fruits. And then you exit the month of Ramadan, inshallah, with farha, with joy and happiness. وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. That you completed those appointed, prescribed timings of the fasting. And then you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. You become of those who are grateful, because there are many yearnings. So we hope to reach the month of Ramadan, to reach it and prepare for it. And then we come out, inshallah, our fast is accepted and we come out better than we were before Ramadan. So it's a madrasa, a schooling. Person remembers that, inshallah. And reminding, inshallah, that if there are other topics that brothers see that that it's suitable to share for what they see in their communities that people are lacking in preparing for the month of Ramadan, or a lot of people may fall short in certain aspects, like such as some people, they look at the month of Ramadan as just a month of eating and drinking in terms of iftar, what they're going to eat, going to different places. They get carried away. And sometimes even the sisters, there a lot of them are so much overwhelmed into preparing suhoor and iftar, where they forget themselves to read some Quran or do some azkar while they're doing that and benefiting from the month of Ramadan. Yes, attending to the needs of their household is important, but they try to attain some khair and goodness. So those who have something to add of that, they can share, inshallah, they can post the icon. But in the upcoming, inshallah, sessions, we'll have more timing. This is, as the brother mentioned, introductory. But before we end, I wanted to point out, because there's a lot of questions that usually come in the month of Ramadan. So we would suggest people to read the Q&A questions that the scholars have, and it's transcribed and translated prior to entering this month, so you don't find yourself in a predicament where you're looking for answers and you're in a situation that needs immediate action. So if you go, for example, on the website, what we have of Toronto Da'wah, we translated a PDF 100 questions on the rulings of fasting by Sheikh Abdullah Al-Iryani. And I think if the brothers who can pull it up, they can perhaps share it, and then we can, the brothers, sisters can see as we're speaking. Also, another one for, I think it's also in English, it is 48 questions for Siyam. 48 questions to Alan for Siyam for Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih Al-Uthaymeen. This is amazing work. It speaks about all the questions that usually people have. If people, brothers and sisters, can go over that and just read it, this will help. And then also on our website, Toronto Da'wah, we have Q&A on questions that relate to fasting by Sheikh Ahmed Najmi, as translated. So if this is something just to prepare with, knowing the ahkam. And there is another article that some of them have put together, what we would call like modern day issues that relate to fasting. Modern day issues, like and really specifically the Mufattirat al-Mu'asira, or Fi Waqt al-Mu'asara. It's a treatise. A person could also benefit from that. It has approximately, we would say, 36 modern day topics that relate to fasting. And it gives you the verdicts of, in simple form, what is the Lajmatu Da'ima say about this? The great scholars, the ulama, they have said about this. And if there's just two opinions, they give it in the strongest. Very simple. It's probably like two pages. I think some have even translated it. Like, for example, these asthma puffers, what's the ruling on that? Nasal dropper, these nasal or eye drops or ear drops, different things that people may ask. All of it laid out in a simple form. Inshallah, that's what I wanted to conclude with, as I know it's late. But if there's anyone else that has suggestion of things that need to be spoken about, maybe we can take that, or they can share it, or else we'll leave it with this, inshallah. Ishaq, you want to add anything, inshallah?
Yeah, what I wanted to add to what you mentioned, Jazakallah khairan, is that a lot of the times when we speak about preparation, we tend to forget what's at hand. So a lot of the times a person might hold off doing righteous deeds until Ramadan. So they'll be running around preparing for Ramadan, although Ramadan is not even guaranteed. And they tend to forget taking these opportunities that they have, the hours that they have, the day that they have. Even tomorrow is not guaranteed.
as we all know, ولا تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا. So sometimes when we speak about preparations, we shouldn't be holding out and leaving off good deeds, that which we can do today for tomorrow. As some of the Arabs, they mention, لا تؤخر عمل اليوم إلى غد. Don't delay today's actions for tomorrow. So it's all good preparing and being in the right state of mind and physically and whatnot. But we should not be preparing for something which is not guaranteed. Rather, those preparation, we make them and we also take advantage of what we have of our time, because tomorrow is not guaranteed. This is an opportunity for anyone to ask any questions that you have related to Ramadan, or any questions related to Talabul Ilm, or any advice from our brother Ustadh Abu Fajr, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, is giving us this opportunity, Jazakallah Khairan. And it honors us, to be honest, wallahi, because we have Faisal and Abu Fajr, Hafidhahullah, they have these kind of Q&A session, counseling sessions on Toronto Da'wah or Masjid Al Istiqama channel on a regular basis, I think Fridays. So I would highly encourage brothers to and sisters to join those live sessions, and also you have them recorded as well. You can go back to that which was recorded previously and see for yourself the amount of benefit that you can take from those. So if you do have any questions, it will be good to ask them.
Also, I just wanted to add, as Jazakallah Khairan for his good thoughts, also we are merely just trying to help what we can, especially with these counseling Q&A sessions. And we just try to convey benefits according to our capability and sharing the statements of the scholars, the statements of the ulama. So a lot of the Q&A, prior when we received them, we presented to some of the scholars and get their answers. And some of the matters that we already have translated, alhamdulillah, we share it, convey it. We would see ourselves as just individuals just trying to yasudduna al-faragh, trying to fill a gap of anything missing and trying to help where we can. Jazakallah khair for his good thoughts. We ask Allah to make us in a way where we can benefit ourselves and our communities. Barakallahu feekum.
وأنت بارك الله فيك وجزاك الله خيرا. Someone has their hands up. Just allow them to speak. تفضل. تفضل سعيد.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Just gonna ask, how would one balance between increased recitation of the Quran and seeking knowledge and revising?
So with and a lot of the misconceptions out there is that when the month of Ramadan comes, some assume that there's no scope to do any other aspects of ilm, of knowledge, of any other topic that it considers to be in reality caters, accommodates you learning the Quran. So a person would initially make his primary concern at-tilawa, reading the Quran, and even more so than his hifz, his memorization. Sheikh bin Baz says initially, he says the jam'u bayn al-maslahatayn. And if you go back to his website, he was asked a particular question: should I do my hifz of my personal memorization, or should I in this month read more? He said that person initially is going to read more and do reflection and try to maybe even complete the whole Quran. But he said he'll try to combine. A lot of the times people are able to combine with the memorization of the Quran and even other aspects of ilm. A person will continue and not more so just completely. Maybe, yes, initially classes because of the scheduling, how Ramadan it has so much scheduling to it, is not probably suitable and convenient for classes, but a person also on the side continues his studies or anything that he's doing, maybe Mutun, just a small portion or viewing of it, and maybe minimize. That is better, because generally al-inqita' ani al-ilm, yani cutting yourself off from learning of whatever a person has begun, it's really hard to do continuation istimrar afterwards. That's really, it's heavy on a lot of people. So I would say continue even with something small, or reviewing here and there of something of benefit. Maybe make a particular time in the day. Some of them right before iftar, they would have a tendency before they do their du'as, they would read over something of interest and benefits, just to make sure that they increase of it. Whether Ramadan or not, other than Ramadan, we know Sheikh Muqbil, he wrote some of his books in Ramadan. Some of his books that he wrote were in Ramadan. Some of the scholars, we see some of the books that they publish on various different topics in the month of Ramadan. So you will continue. And some of our brothers have put something together as a disclaimer to reject that misconception that there's nothing else except the knowledge of the Quran in the month of Ramadan. A person will do other things as well, but just his main focus is the Quran. Inshallah, I hope that clarifies.
جزاكم الله خيرا.
جزاك الله خيرا. My question was, if somebody woke up and they missed two salawat, they missed Dhuhr and it's Asr time, but the time for Asr is going to leave. So if they pray Dhuhr, they will miss the time for Asr as well. So should they give precedence to Dhuhr or Asr in this time? Barakallahu feek.
So when a person is in a situation where he has Salatun Fa'ita and he has Salatun Hadira, this is the topic in fiqh. A prayer that is missed and a prayer that is present. Some scholars, like Sheikh Ibn Baz, he says, يبدأ بالفرض الحاضر. He starts with that which is present, if he fears that the timing of that particular time is going to exit. And then after that, he prays what he missed. He prays what he missed. But if the timing is muwassa, in a scenario where there's some spaciousness, you start with what you missed on the tartib, the order, and then you will start with the prayer that is present. That is the origin a person will do. If a person is, for example, he's in a congregation where they're praying Asr, and he still needs to make up for Dhuhr. Some scholars, they say here that you would intend the intention of Dhuhr behind them. You intend the intention of Dhuhr behind them. And then right after they complete, you would pray your Asr. This is, as they say, because there's some time. Unless the time is layiq, is restricted. Inshallah, I hope that clarifies your question, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Please, if someone misses, I want to ask a question concerning the solar. Let's assume the imam have prayed the first raka. And let's say, okay, I meet Maghrib. I wanted to pray Maghrib, and the imam have prayed the first one. They are in the ruku. So I now join them while they are in the ruku. So immediately I said, Allahu Akbar, and I go ahead to ruku. The imam says, Sami Allah Muhammad. So am I to
continue that with them, or I have to pray it after we finish? If that my question is understandable, sir.
Taib, so I'll give you a general, then we'll follow up to the prayer of the Maghrib that you caught. So when you catch the prayer, if you're referring to what do you do i'tidad, or what do you consider the you cutting the prayer? The stronger. Go ahead, brother. Yes.
No. Immediately, the imam said, "Semi Allah Muhammad." I've joined the prayer already. I'm about to go to the ruku with them, but he has said, "Semi Allah Muhammad," before me going. Getting to the ruku.
Okay, so here, if you do not catch the imam whilst he's in ruku, then you won't consider that rak'ah. You won't consider that rak'ah. The rak'ah's count is mainly determined by the catching of the ruku of the imam in that position. But once he's in another position, it's upon you to come and join him wherever he's in of a positioning of the prayer and continue from there.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum salam.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. My question is about keeping touch with the kinship. I want to find the level of family members that we should keep ties with. Do we keep ties with our cousin, our auntie, or our grandma? What level should we stop when it comes to keeping ties with the kinship?
So in terms of the kinship, generally it is ulul arham of the kinship, the people who have ties with you, of aqarib, of relatives that are either family, very close relatives, or distant relative. So, for example, your aunt, your niece. This is all from the kinship that you will keep ties with. And we know that they all have this relationship of mutual support and help to one another and aid and connection. And some have more precedence than others. وَأُولُوا الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَى بِبَعْضٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Some have more rights. So the way you may do ties of kinship with one, it may not be the same with others. But Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih Al-Uthaymeen, when he was asked what determines silatul rahim, he says the urf, the place of whatever is considered of goodness in that region, of what people will keep ties with, and what will consider what they will consider as qati'a. So it'd be relatively to the norms of your region. If they, for example, they meet on Eid, or they send messages through the phone at a particular time, or they extend greetings, or they visit if one falls ill, or if one is in particular need, all of this is considered from that realm of keeping ties. But once a person totally shows apparent signs of cutting off and not being there, and perhaps the other has some sort of need or something may have happened, and all of the people become negligent towards the other, then this could be from qati'ah, it can be from negligence that could lead to that. So what's safer is to a person to try to keep ties and try to help with being there with their family, finding out what they need, or sending out messages, or just asking about their well-being. This does a lot. إن شاء الله. بارك الله فيك.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Something we see common in a lot of masajid is during Salat al-Tarawih, they dim the lights. Is this something which is established or allowed? Barakallahu feek.
So we have an article on the website, Tunnel Da'wah, about that topic. I can read it for here for you. We shared the verdicts of the scholars. Sheikh Baz was asked about this. Like some of them, they probably turn off the lights, or they leave a little bit, or they dim the lights. And when Sheikh Baz was asked what was the reason, some say it was for more khushu'. Sheikh Baz says, La asl. This has no origin. And they asked him, is it an innovation? He said, this is a mistake. It should be a mistake. And we try the source is there. Also, Sheikh Salih Fawzan, he says, this is an act of innovation. The lights should not be turned off in the masajid for Taraweeh prayer. Like if people are doing tahari and going out of their way and finding like they're seeking nearness to Allah, but we have this is wrong. I mean, this is what we mentioned. Also, we shared a verdict here of Sheikh Mubil. Person shouldn't do that, but he doesn't see it reach the level of innovation, but he says not sunnah. But he says, if a person closes his eyes or turns off the electricity, maybe so they can be far from being noticed or seen or showing off, he says there's no harm in that. Because he said the people differ, and it's not something, a collective thing people should do. Another thing is with the dimming, if it's done like because it's suitable, people already have the lights off and they're praying tahajjud. Like in Yemen and Damaj, we used to have the tahajjud lights off, because that was the time when the lights were off. And we have the Taraweeh lights on, because that's the time where people would have the lights on. So if a person is in the night, bijofil layl, in the darkness of the night, and that's the origin, that's in the dark, and people want it to be like that, then no problem. People can do that. But person shouldn't go extremely out of their way and have these specific lights called Taraweeh lights. Inshallah, I hope that clarifies the question. Barakah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh. The questioner says, my question is, what does it truly mean to obey your husband? Many people speak on this topic, but I can never derive a concise answer. Jazakallah khair.
So, in terms of ma'na ta'atul mar'a, the obedience of a woman to lizawjiha, for her husband, we say generally, firstly, innama ta'a fil ma'ruf. Obedience, the creation, is in goodness. Is in goodness. This is how a person foremost looks at it. The next thing is, it is upon in a scenario where a person, goes back to the customs, the urf, the ma'ruf of the goodness. So the first scenario is la ta'a lil-makhluq fi ma'asiyat al-khaliq. The first level is that obedience, it is within the realm of not falling into the disobedience of Allah. And it comes narrations to support this first stage, because it comes a narration that a woman came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, that her husband command her to connect hair to her own hair of what is the curse. And the Prophet said, لا إنه قد لعن الموصلات. Hadith is in Bukhari Muslim. That should not be allowed because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed those people. And some of the scholars, they commented and they said, واجب على المرأة أن لا تطيع زوجها في معصية. That is the first affair that is incumbent upon a woman, not to obey her husband in disobedience. So the second stage after that is إنما الطاعة في المعروف, obedience is in goodness. And they say it goes back to the عرف, also the customs of the people. The customs of the people were what is recognized of obedient woman to her husband. A woman will try to stick to that and adhere to that. This is what we're talking about, good norms and good customs. So a person would look to that. And they also said it falls into that, the huquq, the general huquq, the rights that the husband has over her, of fulfilling his rights. These are the matters. And in specific, it comes to some of the narrations, تُطِيعُهُ إِذَا أَمَرْ. She obeys him when he asks her to do something. So the origin is that when he asking of something that is not of extreme burden or something that goes within the under the meaning of ishra, of that commitment of marriage, and it's from the maslaha of the marriage and so forth, and these affairs, that she shouldn't refuse in those affairs, and she would obey. And there's fine details and other topics that scholars have verdicts regarding that. Inshallah, we'll leave that to that position and that place. But this is generally the answer to your question, inshallah. Barakallahu feek.
Jazakallah khair, barakallahu feek. May I throw one more question in there?
Abishaq, come out to Tara.
Abba Sakhi, tafaddal.
The question says, is it permissible to incorporate or infuse synthetic fabric into one's hair braid for the purpose of adding color or decoration to obtain a desired look that predominantly resembles one's own hair? The fabric I'm speaking of is similar to yarn. A small piece of fabric is cut and braided, wrapped into the natural hair, not altering the hair natural state or appearance, just enhancing its aesthetics. The natural color and sculpt would be completely visible.
So synthetic hair extensions, or let us small amounts that people do to maybe even add a glow or a color to their hair. What we've seen of some of the fatwa of the scholars is that this should be avoided. This should be avoided because it's from the doubtful matters. الأمور المشتبهات. So this is what a person should avoid. And Imam Shawkani, he has a book on the explanation of the hadith, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنْ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنْ وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ. The halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between the two is a gray zone or doubtful matters. And when we see the hadith, it mentions to avoid, the one who avoids these doubtful matters and unclear matters, that it's like the borderline between halal and haram. فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. Yeah, it saved his honor and his religion. So this is the general affair that the person should try to avoid. This is some of the advices that I've seen. Allah knows best. Barakallahu feek.
JazakAllah khair. Barakallahu feek. Haykallah. Shukran.
طيب أبو إسحاق, maybe we just take one more and we'll leave it with that as it's late for you brothers.
The last question, Afi, حفظك الله, relates to how can women best make use of Ramadan when they come on their menstrual cycle.
طيب سؤال حسن. Generally, a lot of the times this question is posed. We read it in the books asking advice, or that a woman feels that she's missing out. First is to look at this as a sickness, generally speaking. إن هذا قد كتب الله على بنات آدم as comes in hadith. Allah has written this upon the woman, and you can look at it from an angle of a sickness, even though generally we don't consider it as a sickness. But when this falls on a woman and she's disconnected from doing certain deeds, it is written for her, inshallah, continuously what she used to do in a state of good health or in a state when she didn't have any barrier between her and those acts. And it comes to hadith of Musa al-Ash'ari, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدِ أَوْ سَافَرْ كُتِبَ لَهُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ مُقِيمًا صَحِيحًا. When a person falls ill or travels, then it's written for them what they used to do when they were in a state of residence and when they're healthy. So inshallah, same thing with a woman when she was known to be in a state of tuhur, continuous on reading Quran or doing certain acts and so forth, a prayer and voluntary, and it comes to her hayd, something that was out of her will and it prevented her from those particular acts, we hope inshallah that the continuous sunnahs and those deeds of whatever is prevented with hayd of her menses, it's continuous for her inshallah. That's one thing to look at it. Second thing is to know مَا لَا يُدْرَكْ كُلُّهُ لَا يُتْرَكْ جُلُّهُ. If a person can't get all, like for example, they can't pray and they can't fast, then they shouldn't miss out what they could get of good deeds. And we know that when one door of good deed is closed, people, they have other doors that open up for them that they can do about alternative things and that they can resort to. For example, helping others, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentions that helping a sa'i al al-armala wal yatim kalqa'im al-layl wa sa'im al-nahar, the one who aids widows and the orphan, the needy, is like the one standing the nights and fasting the days. So we say, inshallah, a person could also do another good deed to attain high rewards of being with those people who are fast, getting up and during Taraweeh or Tahajjud, they're getting up and praying. That a person maybe opens the door of charity, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ajwad ma yakana yakun. أجود ما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم was in the month of Ramadan, like the most generous he was in the month of Ramadan, as it comes to Hadith ibn Abbas. So this is a door of another good deed that they could focus more on, and also they could read the Quran and recite it as is the month of Ramadan more, and perhaps increase of that. And then another thing too is the niyyah, the intention. Generally the meaning, niyyah to insan khayru min amali, the intention that could do a lot of things. And a person could intend that they would, if they were in a purity state, they would want to come out and pray, and also they want to fast with the Muslims. This is also for them to have that ihtisab, hoping the reward of their intentions. And another thing too is to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said فَإِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ, that you're not missing out in reality. You're going to make up for those days of fasting. But even though the salat is not made up, but you're going to be making up the fasting. And some also encourage to for the sisters to even come out if they can and just hear the Quran during Taraweeh in the masjid while they're sitting at the back. We were told like this is the affair of even some of the sisters in Damaj. There was a group of sisters that were perhaps in the state of this preventative, but they would sit at the back and they would listen to the recitation of the Quran. They would listen to the du'as. And can you aminun? They would say ameen upon the du'as. They would feel like they're a part of it. And they also say, take this from the meaning of Eid, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amara al-huyad. He encouraged, he told and commanded the women that are on their menses to come out for the Eid prayer, even though they're not going to pray. But it comes in the wording, yashhadna al-khayr, hadith Umm Atiyah, that they're going to witness the khayr and the goodness. So if it comes anything of that spirit and they can be part of an event or a tafsir class they can go out and listen to, then they should try to get what they can of khayr. This is a general advice. Allah tabarak ta'ala is best. Barakallahu feek.
Jazakallahu khayran. Sallallahu baraka feek. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us with what we have heard. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.